Today, we are continuing to add to our creed statement. And today, our creed statement is, I believe in the Holy Universal Church, the Communion of Saints. Our sermon title is The Good Life. Would you pray with me? Eternal God and Father, we thank you again for another day. We thank you, O God, for your word. We thank you, O God, for helping us to understand more about what we believe. And Lord, I thank you for every person that's under the sound of my voice. I pray, O God, that you would fill our hearts with your spirit, that you would touch us, O God, that we might receive, and that we might, it might draw us closer unto you. But we do love you today. We do love your church. We love your people. Oh God, and I pray now that the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Oh Lord God, you are my strength and you are my redeemer and you are our soon coming King. We thank and praise you now. It is in the precious name of Jesus Christ and the Lord of God's people say, Amen. 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 There were two business persons who were on vacation on a remote island. And the executive was there so he could relax and clear his head, and I guess the fisherman was there just because that is what he loved to do. So one afternoon, the business person was walking along the beach and he saw the fisherman laying down beside his boat. He stopped to talk to him and he asked him, "Why are you fishing?" The man answered, "Because I have caught enough fish for the day." The executive asked him, "Why don't you go out and catch some more? It's still early in the day." The fisherman wondered to himself, "What would I do with more fish?" So the fisherman asked, and the executive said, "You could earn more money, and then you could buy a bigger boat, and you could go into deeper waters and catch more fish. This would provide you with enough money to buy nylon nets, which would bring you even more fish and more money. Soon you would have enough money to own two boats, maybe even a fleet of boats. Then you would be a wealthy man, just like me." "What would I do then?" the fisherman asked. "Why then, you could begin to experience the good life," the executive said in a very confident manner. At that point, the fisherman spoke up rather abruptly and said to him, "What do you think I'm doing right now?" So you can see by that illustration that these two people disagree as to what a good life is. One of them thought that the good life is being wealthy and accumulating more and more, making the assumption that it constitutes a good life, while the other thought that you could have a good life with less and without working all the time, just for the sake of getting more things that you don't even know what to do with. I don't know if you have ever thought of yourself as having a good life or what having a good life means to you, but certainly you can see that these two people are as far from each other as the East is from the West. I read this and I smiled to myself, because from my earliest years, I always thought I had a good life. Even when I did not fully understand some of the external circumstances that may have dictated otherwise. I don't ever remember, though, going hungry. Neither do I ever remember going without proper clothes to wear. Wealthy? Nah. Rich? Yes. But the reason that I can say that I have now and I've always had a good life is because God gave it to me. Amen. What I mean is that my life is precious. When God created me, and I would say when he created you, he said that it was good. Yes. And you know where I learned that? I learned it in church. Amen. I learned in church not to waste my life, but to make it count for something. Yes. I learned in church that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, is the one that makes it possible for me to live the good life. Yes. In fact, at the end of the sixth day of creation, God saw all that he had made, and he said it was very good. There is a saying that all I really need to know, I learned in kindergarten. These four things: to share everything, to play fair, to not hit people, and to put things back. And these are all good things to know. But in church, I learned the why behind sharing and playing fair and not doing things to others that I would not want done to me and putting things back where they belong. You see, the church introduced me to someone that would be around when the kindergarten teacher was not. So the good life for me is not all about what I have or how much I can get, but it begins with having something on the inside to draw from. It begins with having a solid foundation of faith upon which to build and relationships that matter. Jesus said, a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. The church introduced me to the good life. So I can agree with what the apostles wrote, the Apostles' Creed says, I believe in the church. Now, when we use the word church, what do we really mean? It actually, we use the word in many different ways, at least four different ways I can think of. First of all, we use it when referring to a building. I remember when the Pokemon Go game was quite popular and our church building was one of the places to find. And I would invite people to come in, we had signs outside, but they were only looking for the building. They were not looking for what was inside. The second way we use the word church is when we are referring to a Christian worship event. We say to people all the time, are you going to church on Sunday? Or we may ask them to come to church. And then thirdly, we use the word church when talking about an organized entity with officers, employees, trustees, and ministry programs. People will say, it is my practice to support the church financially on a weekly basis. Finally, church can mean a gathered community of women, men, and children who belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And you here, if you have made Jesus the Lord of your life, you also belong to the church. You are part of a local group of Christians called the body of Christ. When the New Testament speaks about the church, this is really the definition that it is referring to. Now, from a practical standpoint, many times when I, and probably you, refer to the church, we are combining all four of these definitions, the building, the worship event, the organized entity, and the gathered community. Because we have come to understand that the first three definitions only exist and are important because of the last one. If there is not a gathered community, no body of Christ, then we don't need a building or an institution or a worship event. But because of the gathered community, we need all of these things. When Jesus said that he was going to build his church, though he did not have a physical building in mind, what he meant was he was building a community of believers who would love one another and be unified around the common purpose of being disciples and then making disciples. The church is the only thing that Jesus said that he was going to build. And not only was he going to build it, but he also said he was going to give it life. If you think about it, you could purchase the most beautiful house and have the most expensive furniture in the house. But it is really the family that gives it life. Otherwise, it's just brick and mortar. You see, the body of Christ is what brings life to this building that we know as church. Jesus could have said and done a lot of things, and there are a lot of great institutions in the world. But he never said that he was going to build anything else. Not a hospital, not a college, not an orphanage, not a restaurant, nothing. Not a daycare center, but a church. That tells us that all of these other things are built by human initiative, although they are good and we need them, but the church holds a special place in the heart of God. You see, there is nothing else that is blessed like the church. Furthermore, I believe in the church because Jesus said that the gates of hell would not overpower or prevail against it. We have been given an awesome trust to stand strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. On any given day, there are articles and surveys about people leaving the church, the body, for one reason or another. And maybe they gather at Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts or somewhere else on Sunday because they don't need the church. They don't need to hear about the good life that God gives. They can make a good life on their own. They just need to belong to a group. But you see, the church is more than that, and it has to be more than that. The church that Jesus is building is a living organism that will exist until he comes, because it is built by the Holy Spirit. The church of Jesus Christ is empowered by the Holy Spirit. The church that Jesus is building exists for one purpose and one purpose only, and that is to carry out the purposes and the will of God in the earth. The church that Jesus is building is going to overcome evil in the end. Last week, I was talking to Carl Herb, and we were just talking about the world and things that were happening, and we were going from one thing to the other. He was talking about some things going on in Naugatuck, and we just continued talking about different kinds of things, but at the end of the conversation, he said to me, "Pastor, I believe that in the end, good will win." And I said to him, "I do too." The church will still be standing in the end. And I believe that we are part of a winner. The early church is our model. With all of the opposition and fear that they were faced with, they managed to have the presence of mind to realize the sister church was not their idea. Neither did they give birth to it, that maybe it could stand the test of time, but only if they continued in their devotion to it. So our text this morning tells us how they obeyed the Spirit of God and how the church grew and it became successful. In many ways, if you look at verse 42, it encapsulates everything that Luke wants to illustrate about the strength and the unity and commitment of this infant church. The good life of the Spirit kept them fired up. Verses 43 to 47 are simply specific examples of what a Christ body community built on these five tenets may expect. Luke describes five telltale marks that together creates this body of believers. He said that teaching, fellowship, the breaking of bread, prayers, and giving are the things that hold what God is building together. Verse 42 says this: they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and prayers and giving to support the church. You see, the same things that built the church then are the same things that will keep the church alive and well now. And it's not any different than any other things in life. Sometimes young people think that going to college is party time. But pretty soon they find out that the same thing that got them there are the same things that will keep them there. Or how about a job? You start and you go on time, you get your work done, and you display leadership. Then you decide that you don't need to continue doing those things. Pretty soon you'll find yourself out of a job. And how about a marriage? You start out showing each other love and respect and care, and then you decide that you don't need to do that anymore. And you find out that the same way you started with the basic things are the things that will keep you growing and moving forward, and so it is with the church. They basically did five things that churches are still doing today, but they started with devotion and commitment. The Bible says they devoted themselves and continued in the apostles' doctrine. They didn't do it one day and then decide the next day it's no longer any good. So number one, they heard the word of God. You see, teaching helps us move our beliefs from our heads to our hearts. They met in the temple courts to hear the word of God empowered by the Holy Spirit, so they would know how to live when they were not in the gathered community. And number two, it says they fellowship with one another. They had small group meetings, and that was to build relationships with one another. You remember that Jesus said that we are to love one another, that we are to take care of one another. And so in small group settings, we begin to know each other. We begin to know each other's need, each other's pain, each other's hurts. And we begin to rally around that and really begin to know each other deeply. So they fellowship with one another. And then they broke bread from house to house. They communed with one another. Now, as we have come today to have a communion together to share the body and blood of the Lord, that is the unity that we all have together. And they had that as they went from house to house. And then they gave to support the mission and the ministry so that no one in the church had left. These things were so successful for them and are still the same things that will be successful for us. Luke portrays a church that lived in an attractively countercultural yet joyful community. It reminds us of where we are today. It seems like not much has changed, but we are still the church of the Lord Jesus Christ that prays, that praises, that breaks bread, and it is one that we continue, that God will continue adding to. And it is the church of the Lord Jesus Christ that can offer the good life to others. You see, what I want you to understand today is that the church is not my idea, it's not your idea. It is God's idea born by His Holy Spirit. It is God's work, it is God's building, it is God's body, and yes, I believe in the church. The church is amazing. The church provides the basis for a good life. And if we continue to introduce people to the good life that God gives, then we will see the fruit that will for years to come. Think about your own children that you brought up in the church. Think about how you taught them the values and are continuing, for those of you that are still raising children, you are continuing to teach them the things that Jesus taught his disciples. And you are beginning to see fruit develop from their life. I love the church because Jesus loves the church. Amen. It is his bride, and he is coming back for it.
Hallelujah.
When people's lives are transformed in the church, they are put on the road to the good life. If they fall, they can get back up again. If they are rooted and grounded in the Lord, they know what direction to go in. And last Sunday, I said that the Holy Spirit was sent to make a difference. And oh, what a difference he has made. He has made a difference over and over in your life and in my life. He's made a difference over and over in the church as we have continued to be devoted to the apostles' doctrine, as we have continued to fellowship, as we have continued to teach the word of God. God has shown himself faithful. Do you believe in the church? You see, the church is what I call, when we are developing the good life. It's not about wealth, and it's not about leisure per se, but it's about having a solid and a firm foundation that God has planted on the inside of us. And as we come to church, we nurture what God has put on the inside of us. And I can promise you that if you have never experienced the good life, I want to commit you and I want to introduce you to the Lord Jesus Christ today. You see, in the Lord's church, God teaches us how to be respectful. God teaches us good manners. And God teaches us what it means to walk in this earth, not worrying about what's going on the outside, but making sure that we are continuing to nurture the Spirit of God that is on the inside. And so I said to you today that I know that I have a good life, and if you have the Lord Jesus Christ, you have a good life. Because God said when he made each one of us, that it was very good. And if it was very good then, it is very good now. So I pray that we would love the church, that we would support the church, that we would follow the church's teachings, because it will help us to develop in all things pertaining to life and to godliness. Amen.
Amen.
Father, I thank you today for your heartbeat. I thank you, O God, for your Holy Spirit. I thank you, O God, for your instruction. I thank you, God, for your ways. I thank you, God, for the unity that you call us to have in the church. Because we're human beings, we're not perfect. But Lord, we yield ourselves over to you. That what you have done in us might be displayed in the earth. Father, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for your words. We thank you for Christ. And we thank you for what you are building. And we thank you that we are a part of what you are doing, even now in the 21st century. Lord, there may be those under the sound of my voice that have pain in their bodies. Lord, I pray that you would touch them even now. Lord, or may not even understand what I am even talking about. Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit would touch them even now, and that you would bring clarity. Father, I pray there's anyone under the sound of my voice that does not know you, Lord, that they would ask you to come into their hearts and to live on the inside of them, to shape them and develop them by your word. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you for your love. And we ask it all in the name of Jesus Christ. And let all the people of God say,